Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together. Lord, bind us together in love. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together in love. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together in love.
Good morning and welcome to worship. This is our stay-at-home worship today for the first time, and it's all kind of a great experiment, so we'll see how all of this goes. Hopefully you received via email the resource for today's worship. If not, just lean back, relax, and hopefully your heart will be touched this day. I began with Bind Us Together because binding is a theme that we are going to hear in our gospel lesson today, but also because I am so aware of how isolated we can be as we are on our stay-at-home orders. And my experience the last few days, I don't think is unusual. On Friday, I forgot to take my medicine. Yesterday, which is usually my laundry day, I completely forgot to do my laundry. Everything is just so out of whack, and our minds and our hearts are just in every direction. And so I'm realizing I have to be more aware of the important daily rituals of my life that, yes, include taking my medicine and include doing my laundry once a week. Jolene, you once asked me, do you really need a reminder to do your laundry? Yes, that's the answer to that question. So partly because of my own experience of only a couple of days of our stay-at-home order, and because of our need to be connected even when we are separated, I want to announce that tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., I will begin a daily devotional. It'll only be about 15 minutes, and if you're not available at 9 o'clock, you can do it at any time because it'll be posted on the Grace Facebook page and the Genesee Facebook page. But part of what I want to do with this is that to get some interaction with folks, some prayer requests, some check-in, as we also delve into scripture and are reminded on a daily basis that we are not alone, that God is always with us, is always loving us, and will never abandon us, and that the body of Christ is alive and well in our community, even though we can't see each other, we can't be with each other, the body of Christ is alive. So starting tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., tune in. If you can't watch it at 9, I still want your comments. I still want your prayer requests. If you want to send a private prayer request to me that isn't open to the public, you can email it to me, whatever. I want to be in contact, and I want us to connect one to another. So bind us together, Lord. Bind us together in love. We begin our worship. I invite you to join with me in the prayer of the day. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
There's my congregation in the back. You didn't know if he was there. Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son came into the world to free us all from sin and death. Breathe upon us the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ and serve you in righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading, we will read responsively, Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord.
O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication.
If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand?
Yet with you is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared.
I wait for you, O Lord. My soul waits. In your word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who keep watch for the morning. More than those who keep watch for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord, for the Lord there is steadfast love. Oh, with the Lord there is plenteous redemption.
For the Lord shall redeem Israel from all your sins.
It's very interesting doing a responsive reading with your husband sitting on the couch. This is what we learn as we go along. Our gospel reading is from the Gospel of John. And it's a long one, so sit back and relax. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother, Lazarus, was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right. Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus, had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he have opened the eyes? He who opened the eyes of the blind have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." Then he said this. When he said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord. One of the visions that remains with me over the last few weeks is a picture of a priest in Italy with 40 caskets lined up. I don't know if he was doing the funeral, if he was doing a commendation, or doing I don't know what he was doing exactly. It was some kind of spiritual ritual. But that image of this priest alone with these caskets And knowing that the people who loved these folks who were now dead could not be there. And just the emptiness, the sorrow of that image is so strong. But at the same time, that image is a confirmation that no matter what is going on in the world, in our own lives, that we are not alone. The priest was there with them in the midst of all this chaos, representing the church, but also being a symbol that God is there as well, that God is with each one of us, wherever we are in our isolation. The image of Jesus standing in front of the tomb is a strong one as well. He's greatly disturbed. And unlike the priest with the caskets, there are many people gathered around. The mourners are gathered. Jesus' disciples are there to see. The family, the neighbors have come together to mourn this man, Lazarus. And with this image, if we knew nothing else, we would just say that this is, you know, the dead are dead. And he should have come sooner. It's what the people were saying. It's what Martha said. If you'd come sooner, he wouldn't have had to have died. And then Jesus does three things. So first, he orders the stone removed. And this is despite the fact that the stench is already starting to rise. Lazarus has been dead 4 days, and that means he was dead, not just possibly in a coma or he'll wake up. No, he was dead. There's no going back from dead. That was the understanding. And then the second thing that Jesus does is that he gives thanks to God the Father. And what does he thank God for? Hearing his words. Always hearing his words. And Jesus says in the Johannine way, I'm not saying these things because I need to be told. I'm saying these things so that the people who are gathered here can believe. And then the third thing, Jesus commands Lazarus to come out in a loud voice. Lazarus, come out. And in this moment, you know, we could be thinking, well, poof, all right, we are safe now. We've got the resurrection. You know, life is good. It, you know, this is about our life after death. Resurrection, we've got it. We see Jesus bringing life from death, but it's way more than that. So there's two really important things that we also need to see around this image at the tomb. One thing happens before he gets to the tomb, and one thing happens after Lazarus has emerged. So Jesus, when he finally returns to Bethany, when Lazarus has been dead that 4 days, which means that he's really dead, he has this conversation with Martha. And Martha says, basically, why didn't you come earlier? You could have saved my brother. And Jesus says to her, your brother will rise again. And she says, I know that. At the resurrection on the last day, I know that. And Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Now we tend to stop at the resurrection. I am the resurrection. Because, you know, that's about our afterlife, right? And that's the focus, right? But that's only part of what Jesus is talking about. He goes on, those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. The resurrection again. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. You see, it is in the living, really living, where we find Jesus. Not living in fear of death, not hiding in our fear, not frozen from action, but truly living. Because Jesus is the resurrection, but he is also the life with a capital L. And this life that is Jesus is all about relationship. Relationship with God, relationship with our neighbors, relationship with ourselves. That's what life is. Does Martha understand this? I doubt it. Do we understand it? Maybe on a good day. So the second important thing then comes at the end of the story, after Lazarus emerges from the tomb. And we have to see the image of Lazarus, a dead man, wrapped up in the funeral cloths, wrapped up tight, looking like a mummy. His hands and his feet were bound. And I'm going to ignore the vision of how he actually came out of the tomb with his hands and feet bound. We will leave that for the comedians. But what is important is what Jesus says after Lazarus has emerged. He commands, unbind him and let him go. So Lazarus is still bound in death, and he needs to be unbound. And Jesus, though, instead of saying, oh, I'll take care of it, running up there and taking off those funeral cloths, he says, you do it. Unbind him and let him go. It's a command to the community, to all of those who had gathered around, the mourners, the neighbors, the family. They are the ones to unbind him and then to let him go. So we have these two sayings. One, a declaration, I am the resurrection and the life. And the command, unbind him and let him go. It's those two things together that can really help us as we try to live through these crazy, crazy days. You see, it's the things that bind us that keep us from truly living. Whether it's our fears of coronavirus, whether it's our loneliness in isolation, or our alcoholism or drug addiction, or our desire for wealth, or whatever it is that binds us. It's those things that bind us, that keep us from living, that actually make us dead. But in this interesting juxtaposition that Jesus gives us, being bound in relationship is what unbinds us. Being bound in our relationships with God, with our neighbors, with our brothers and sisters in Christ, with all of creation, being connected. That song, those cords that cannot be broken, that bind us in Christ, that is what unbinds us. We need one another. We need one another in order to be able to truly live, to let go of those things that hurt us, that we do to ourselves. We need the community. We need it in our isolation now more than ever. We are not in this life alone. We are in it together with God, with our neighbor, and with ourselves. And that is the life that Jesus calls us to. That Jesus binds us together. And it is in that binding that we are set free. Amen. And now I invite you to go to the second side of the second part of your worship resource, and we will sing Baptized and Set Free. Together with the church, let us profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In the God of power, the God of love, we lift up our concerns for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Lord God, in this time of crisis, this time of chaos, we pray for your church, that we can continue to move forward in our mission, reaching out with the good news so that all might know that in you is life. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious and loving God, we pray for the nations of the world, and we pray for their leaders. We pray for the medical workers around the world who are trying to fight this virus. Lord, we ask that you give all leaders wisdom and compassion. Help them to make good decisions for their people. Help them to keep in the forefront the desire for the common good of all people, so that together we will emerge as nations stronger than before. Lord, in your mercy. Healing God, we pray for doctors and nurses, for technicians, for those working in the medical labs, for those working to find cures, to find medicines that will help those who are working on a vaccine. Lord, we lift them all up. Their work is so important and so exhausting. And so we ask that your hand of comfort be upon them, and that you lift their burden just a little to help them make it through. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of all, we pray for all who are in any need, those who are facing economic trials, those who are sick with the coronavirus or any other disease, those who are feeling the effects of isolation in depression and hopelessness. Be with those who are homeless, who have no place to stay at home. Be with those who are hungry, and help those who are trying to meet that need. Lord, in your mercy. For what else do the people of God wish to pray? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all time and places, we give you thanks for those who have gone before us. We especially give thanks for those whose lives have been cut short in these last few weeks. We thank you for giving them to us to walk through this life, and we give thanks for what they have taught us as they faced their own deaths. Lord, may we come to your banquet, trusting that you are always with us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Bound together by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the prayer that our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the blessings of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with you always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is Day by Day. No, not the one from Godspell. I disappointed my husband this morning. Day by Day, you'll find the words on the second page of the sheet. Wash your hands. Stay home. Watch out for your neighbors. And share the good news. Thanks be to God.